Football now for three quarters today. The Florida State Seminoles were stuck in a self-destruct mode, but somehow, someway, the Seminoles did an about-face in the final period to come away from Chapel Hill, North Carolina, with their sixth win of the year. Seminoles turned the ball over on five of their first six possessions, four by fumble. Eric Thomas first right there. The crowd was loving it up there, their homecoming. Tony Smith would soon follow, but despite the charity, the Tar Heels could muster only two scores. The first one here, Kevin Anthony to Earl Winfield at 7-0. FSU gave it back once more. Thomas intercepted, but the best UNC could do was a field goal. A school record 54-yarder by Kenny Miller, and it's 10-0 at the half. Credit the FSU defense for keeping it close. Late in the third, FSU getting back on track. Martin Mayhew will pick off his first pass of the day and the first of his career, but he wasn't through, as you'll see later. It led to a Schmidt field goal, and FSU trailed 10-3. Freshman Chip Ferguson came off the bench a second time in the game, playing in front of his home folks. Goes up top, 49 yards to Hassan Jones. FSU's in business. Figure that's a good combo. Go to Jones again. This one ties the game at 10-all. FSU got the ball back. They drove downfield. Gave Schmidt the chance to win it from 51 yards. Seminoles lead for the first time, 13-10. Only a couple of minutes to play. UNC one more chance. Anthony looks for Winfield, but there's Mayhew again. And the Florida High grad will take it the distance, 62 yards. And goodness me, the final score kind of makes it look easy, 20-10. FSU lucky to get out alive. It was the third time this season the Seminoles have had to come from behind after halftime. The second time, Chip Ferguson has had to direct the comeback. But during the early going today, it didn't matter who was at quarterback. The Seminoles just could not retain possession of the football.
I can believe, you know, that we won the ball game because of defensive play, but not offensively. We, like I said, we turned the ball over five times the first half, and then I came out in the second half and threw that first that interception, and that's six turnovers right there, and you're not supposed to win ball games with that many turnovers.
Now, ABC has officially picked up next week's Miami-Florida State game at Doe Campbell Stadium, so plan on an afternoon kickoff. Closer to home, it was homecoming.
As Iowa, which had been a consensus unanimous number one last week, loses one of its first-place votes, despite the fact the Hawkeyes beat Northwestern by 39 points. Somebody was impressed enough with Penn State's win over West Virginia. Air Force still 7. Oklahoma State, though, moves up to 8th. Florida State up a spot. Miami of Florida cracks the top 10. Remember, the Hurricanes weren't even in the poll for a long time. Oklahoma 11th. Ohio State moves up to 12th after beating Minnesota. Arkansas
from behind victory at Chapel Hill, at least for the offense. But a win is a win is a win.
We made a lot of mistakes on offense and defense, and you know, through the game we started getting our composure back together, and we started, you know, playing ball like we can.
The 20-10 victory was also a showcase for freshman Chip Ferguson, who's just been getting better every game. His coach was impressed. Ferguson, businesslike.
I had to go in there and do the job and get things done. The offense was struggling at first, and finally, we came through in the second half and started working out good.
It has surprised me he's been able to produce in critical situations like he has, because he's being called to duty a lot quicker than he anticipated and we anticipated.
Next come the Miami Hurricanes, who have really hit their stride.
Well, they lost their first football game, have not lost since. Mm-hmm. In fact, hadn't even hardly been close since. And I think their desire to win a national championship is probably the greatest factor they'll have.
Florida A&M's homecoming second half.
From the end zone.
Well, you see on this replay, Mike Green, number 58, Lee Williams, 99 and 57 from the Chargers, all got fooled. They didn't pay any attention to reverse a bootleg and got caught out of position in the chase position.
Chris Barr putting the uprights. And the Raiders, their defense got it back for them once, or got it back for them twice. They get points on either occasion.
12 at Doe Campbell Stadium Saturday afternoon. That's how the UPI Board of Coaches see it. The top 20 out this morning ranks Florida State 9th, the University of Miami number 12. But the Iowa Hawkeyes are still the Hammers, the unanimous choice as numero uno. Perfect at 8-0, number 6. Then you have Ohio State, Oklahoma, Florida State, and the Baylor Bears. Arkansas heads the next batch. Then come Miami, Okie State, UCLA, and LSU. BYU, the week's big loser. The Seminoles are the owners of a very bizarre distinction heading into Saturday's encounter with Miami. They're the only team in the country to use, count them, four different starting quarterbacks and still manage a 6-1 record, despite the obvious lack of continuity. There was sophomore Danny McManus, who started the first two games against Tulane and Nebraska. He was knocked out against Memphis State, and along came Kurt Coker, who took over the Tiger game and then started Kansas the next week. Eric Thomas has started the last 2 weeks against Tulsa and North Carolina, and the fourth will be freshman Chip Ferguson, largely due to his poise when the Seminoles were in tight situations and his spectacular success.
My back was against the wall, and then against North Carolina, our backs were against the wall, and yet he was still able to function. So I thought that was a good sign. But if we were starting a day, Ferguson will start at quarterback because he is performing right now better than the other quarterbacks.
The NFL
leading up to Oklahoma just a couple of weeks ago, another one underway now leading into Florida State. How do you deal with that challenge as a coach?
Well, I think because of the way we low-keyed this past week, we're going to be able to concentrate more on Florida State because the guys were looking toward Florida State. And so I think it's going to be a lot easier this week than what it was a week ago.
You're not going to have any trouble getting them up for Florida State. Here's some video of the Seminoles.
Here they've got Chip Ferguson throwing the football to Hassan Jones a week ago against Tulsa when they scored, I guess, 70-something points.
Mm-hmm.
You got Tony Smith, their top-notch tailback. He's one of the top tailbacks in the country running the football. You know, Florida State played us better than anybody that we played a year ago, and they're a well-coached football team. They have great athletes, and I know that they're going to be ready to play. In fact, their coach scouting the game was on our field prior to the game talking to our recruits and talking to the opposing coaches. They're going to be ready to play. I'm sure they're looking toward this game just as much as we are.
You got a big
everybody, there will be no lull before the storm for the ninth-ranked Seminoles. With their biggest test of the season just 3 days away now, Florida State has run into an unexpected problem. His name is Juan, as in tropical storm. The heavy rains from Juan forced the Seminoles to practice indoors today. It's the third day in a row that's happened. The defensive unit prepared for the Miami Hurricanes in Tully Gym, while the offense worked out in the Tallahassee-Leon County Civic Center. Bobby Bowden says the weather has become a major headache in his team's preparations for the 12th-ranked Canes. As for Miami, well, they've been working out under sunny South Florida skies. You know, rain or shine, no one can blame Miami if it relishes trips to Tallahassee. When the Hurricanes arrive in the capital city, somehow the home field advantage turns into a disadvantage for Florida State. This is mystifying business. So we did the only thing we could do, put the best on the case. Our chief inspector, Scott Atwell.
I was working city side on the late night shift when the call came through. It was a woman rambling hysterically, something about home field disadvantage.
Nothing but the facts, ma'am.
She raised some good questions, questions which needed answers. I went to investigate. It's my job. My name's Atwell. I'm a reporter. Tuesday, 6:45 p.m., we uncovered some evidence. 1981, Jim Kelly and company roll into Tallahassee. Speedy Neal hauls in a couple of big screen passes. Miami wins 27-19. 1 year later, FSU playing at Miami. Kelly Lowry hits Orson Mobley across the middle. The Seminoles come away as big, 24-7 winners. Back in Tallahassee the following year, Hurricane hopes rest on a last-second field goal. It's good. Miami wins 17-16, and they're off to an Orange Bowl date with Nebraska. 1 year removed from the national championship, Hurricane quarterback Bernie Kosar is hounded by a swarming FSU defense. Miami is stifled on their home turf, FSU in a 38-3 runaway. The evidence was all there, plain to see in black and white. In 28 meetings, Miami held a 7-1 advantage playing in Tallahassee. With a 12-8 record, the Seminoles were king in South Florida. There had to be an explanation.
Atwell, city side.
Bowden, coach.
About all this evidence?
I don't know of any like that. It just should be the other way around. You should dominate on your home field as far as the percentage of wins are concerned. But again, this has not worked that way.
Maybe this time around it will change. Hopefully it will. You know, because if history repeats itself, we're in trouble.
It was Santayana who predicted, those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. Perhaps the Seminoles have learned their lesson. Scott Atwell, Channel 6 Eyewitness Sports at Florida State.
Great job. Thank you, Scott. Florida State, after 3 days of persistent team outside to try and work out the kinks and knock off a few layers of rust. But as you see, Juan got the better part of this action. The ninth-ranked Drive hosts the 12th-ranked Miami Hurricanes at 3:30 Saturday afternoon. It'll be time again for Florida State players to look into the camera, wave, and scream, Hi, Ma. The Miami game will be the fifth time this season the Tribe has been on the national tube. Every time that red light goes on, it means big money for the athletic department. I'm talking world-class dough. But where does it go? Dot Evans has the financial particulars for us.
Florida State Seminoles have become America's college football darlings with four appearances on TV in their first seven games and two more to go. And it's done wonders for their image.
I think that it has to do with name recognition, name identity. People hear Florida State, they think big offense, they think winning football program.
But exposure isn't the only thing Florida State's gotten. There is money involved, and we are talking about big money. For instance, the Tulane game on WTBS netted the Tribe $125,000. The ABC nationwide feed of the Nebraska game was worth $287,000 plus. Throw in another $125,000 from TBS for the Memphis State game. Then another $125,000 from the Auburn game. This weekend's ABC regional game against Miami will kick in another $250,000. And the Tribe's ESPN appearance against South Carolina next month adds in another $262,000. Another $130,000 comes from the CFA's television package. Total worth $1,305,000 just from television. It helps Florida State with some otherwise postponed projects.
And then when the TV comes through that again, that we go to our wish list and the kind of things that are going to give us another step up to give us a kind of national program that we're interested in all 16 of our programs.
It makes a little better relaxed atmosphere out here when we're considering and planning our recruiting projects and processes down the way to know that we have picked up some extra income.
Recognition, money, and an edge in recruiting. How can you go wrong being the most televised team in the country? Don Evans, Channel 6, Eyewitness Sports.
Thank you, Don. Through when rain?
Bobby tells it like it is. Bert tells it like it was. And the Seminoles had all the excitement you ever wanted to see and then some. Make a date with Bobby and Bert and Florida State. Sundays this fall on The Bobby Bowden Show. It's something special.
See The Bobby Bowden Show Sunday at noon and 11:30 on Channel 6.
Fun is just about dissipated, but as far as the Seminoles go, the eye of the storm has only just blown into town. The Miami Hurricanes went right from the airport to Doe Campbell Stadium this afternoon for a light workout. After 4 days of heavy rain, needless to say, the stadium is soaked. FSU officials did their best to fix the problem, though. The answer, a helicopter to blow dry the field. As of right now, the gridiron is in pretty good shape. Kickoff comes at 3:30 tomorrow afternoon at Doe Campbell. When you have a game of Florida magnitude, a lot of
points against Colorado last week, but the defense...
Florida teams in our top 10 square off in Tallahassee with the Major Bowl scouting both.
Last year, Florida State's defense sacked Bernie Kosar six times. The Seminoles were all over him, his early exit giving backup Vinny Testaverde his longest stint of the year. This year, Testaverde is the main man, and has completed over 62% of his passes and leading the Canes to six straight wins.
Vinny has played extremely well. He's fourth in the country in passing efficiency. He's fourth in total offense. He has really been the catalyst for our offense, been the focal point. Throws the ball extremely well, and he has been able to help in our pass protection in that when we have a breakdown, he has the foot speed to avoid the rush, and that has helped because we have four new offensive line starters, and of course we have two new wide receivers, and his ability has overcome some of the inexperience at other positions.
Florida State's quarterback position has been split into quarters, with four different players taking turns. This week, it's up to freshman Chip Ferguson.
We're going to start our fourth quarterback this year because of necessity. Chip Ferguson, a freshman, a true freshman, I wish he was a redshirt freshman, is going to start the football game. He's got a lot of potential, but he's got a lot to learn, and I hope he has learned enough to keep us in this ball game. You can about afford a loss. Well, we've had our wild card, and so has Miami. We can't afford two if we want to stay up there with the big guys.
Oklahoma's defense was not win over Iowa State is no indication of what problems a talented quarterback presents to the Sooners. KU has one of the best.
The Hurricanes are now 8-1 at Doe Campbell Stadium after a come-from-behind win against the ninth-ranked Florida State Seminoles this afternoon. As Scott Atwell tells us, it was a case of a quarterback who couldn't be stopped despite taking a pounding all day long.
For a brief shining moment or two, it was all good news for the record Doe Campbell crowd of 62,000. Two plays after a botched Miami punt snap, freshman Chip Ferguson found Hassan Jones in the corner, and the Seminoles had an early 7-0 advantage. Miami countered on the ensuing drive. Vinny Testaverde fires 10 yards to Brian Blades. The game is tied at 7. A Ferguson interception put the ball in Testaverde's hands once again. First play of the drive, 38 yards. Blades has two in a row. The Hurricanes have a 14-7 lead. Saturday's contest marked the return of an old friend for the Seminoles, the blocked punt. The first of the year came here, but the play was called back. Easy come, easy go. Next play, the try will do it again. This time, Lincoln High's Brian K. Davis recovers in the end zone. The game is tied at 14. Derek Schmidt's 37-yard field goal put Florida State up by 3, but the Tribe would take a 10-point lead into the locker room when Ferguson found Pat Carter all alone over the middle. It was 24-14, Florida State at intermission. Miami bounced back on their first possession of the second half. Alonzo Highsmith capped a 77-yard drive with this 2-yard run. FSU's lead had dwindled 24-21. Derek Schmidt offered breathing room with a 44-yard field goal and made the score 27-21. The Seminole defensive front was after Testaverde all afternoon, sacking the Miami signal caller 7 times for a minus 71 yards. But Testaverde battled back. Down by 6 points, he spied the game winner with 9:55 left. Florida State with only 10 men on the field. 30 yards to Michael Irving. UM led 28-27. 4 minutes later, Testaverde worked his magic for the final time. 2 yards to Brett Perryman. It gave the Miami quarterback 399 passing yards. It gave the Hurricanes a 35-27 victory.
Testaverde was the difference. There's no doubt. You just have to say Testaverde was the difference tonight. You had a senior, poised quarterback that has hurt us a lot more than Kozar ever hurt us. He's hurt us more. Kozar never hurt us like this guy does.
Vinny Testaverde's an excellent quarterback after, I think, the way we pressured him and pounded on him. And, you know, they came back and came back. Have the utmost respect for them. They're an excellent offense. You know, they just played their hearts out.
The Hurricanes and Seminoles knew full well the winner of tonight's game would remain alive in the hunt for a New Year's Day bowl. Now, Florida State will be playing in somebody's postseason game, but the Seminoles know the big one has gotten away. Scott Atwell, Channel 6 Eyewitness Sports at Florida State.
And while
late in the first quarter, Jeff Feagles took a low snap from the center and had it blocked by the Seminole defensive line. A strong safety, Brian Davis, fell on the pigskin, making it 14-all. In the second quarter, Florida State tight end Pat Carter will catch a 20-yard bullet from Mr. Ferguson. Derek Schmidt later added a field goal, and that made it 24-14, Florida State going into the locker rooms at halftime. But in the second half, Vinny Testaverde threw for 2 more scores, and the final was the Hurricanes winning it by the count of 35-27. Testaverde wound up today with 339 yards passing and 4 touchdowns. Well, today's wet...
It's time for another great moment in Florida State football history with former Seminoles Burt Reynolds and Vic Prinzi.
1964, Burt, let's talk about a great football team at Florida State. Back in the era of Bill Peterson, Steve Tenzi, Fred Blitnikoff, the Magnificent Seven.
The Magnificent Seven, and what a ball club. I mean, just incredible stats they had going into this game. They had never been scored on.
And that's the amazing part. They were undefeated, hadn't been scored upon, and they were going to face the 5th-ranked team in the nation, Kentucky Wildcats.
You know, I'll give you a statistic that's just even scarier than that. At the end of the ball game, the Wildcats had made total rushing 24 yards.
24 yards, and that's why they came up with the Magnificent Seven. Scary. I think they were crowned then. Tremendous defensive football team. Great talent on that defensive line. But the whole key to the ball game, again, goes back to such a great immortal passing combination in Florida Tenzi. State. Steve Tenzi and Fred Blitnikoff. That ball game was, Florida State coming in was under Bill Peterson, just getting a little bit of recognition.
Yeah, it was the first time that they'd gotten into the AP top 10 after that game.
Yes, it is tremendous. And also, we went back and looked at our little notes. They got the Dunkel ratings. Where Florida State
number one, of course,
ranked number one. I mean, let's face it, no one scores on you. And the score of that ball game, of course, was 48-6. And the only touchdown came on a Bird punt return in the waning seconds of the ball game for the first touchdown against the Magnificent Seven. So 1964, Florida State, Kentucky. Great ball game for Florida State, 48-6.
Great football players, great team.
Join us again next week for another great moment in Florida State football with Burt Reynolds and Vic Prinzi. All the excitement.
You guessed it. Walter Payton on a
Capital City Bank Group. Here today, here tomorrow.
A Sunshine Bowl in Tallahassee.
Two teams looking for the pot of gold that you'll find at the end of the rainbow. Miami says that the bird is the word, but the Seminole war cry can be heard. We're on a roll toward a major bowl.
With a win.
Early on a snap, we get a break. Hit 88 from 8, things are looking great. But Vinny Testaverde gives us a close shave. Blades cuts our lead away. Then Blades once more stabs us with a score.
Sorry, Eric Williams, 14-7.
Now here comes the block that shocked the crowd.
Penalty?
Bobby Bowden's getting loud. Next, can't believe it, we block it again. This time justice is served in the end. Now fake a punt, that's a clever stunt.
Schmidt takes 3.
A chip shot partner with a juggling score. Miami comes back, give them 7 more. Then Vinny Testaverde, now 30's the word. Both to Michael Irvin, that dirty bird. Eric Williams gills, scoreboard reads still.
That hurts.
Miami pushes in for 6 from 2. Vinny passed the test, now Bernie who? The Tallahassee lass, he's feeling blue. The Tallahassee.
This could be your dream.
Well, let's move ahead now. The number 11 team is Oklahoma State. Number 12 is UCLA. LSU is 13. Auburn is 14 after losing to the Gators. Georgia all the way back up to number 15 after dropping out a few weeks ago. FSU is the 16th team in the land. Tennessee is 17. Now, if you're looking for culprits for the Miami loss, there's places to look on both sides of the ball. Perhaps the most obvious, the play of the defensive secondary. After the game, I asked Coach Bowden if he thought the secondary had done the job.
Well, happy with him? I think so. I hadn't looked at the film yet, but I think so, yeah. I think he played pretty good. I'll have to see.
On Sunday, the coach looked at the films, and he did change his mind a bit. He told the boosters today at lunch that the defensive line and linebackers played great, but that the secondary did not. Deion Sanders didn't think it was entirely the players' fault.
Not really. We don't really get our praise in like we really wanted to. You know, the coaches was a little slow on that, and plus that, you know, when the receivers, they'd be already out there lined up, and we had to take time to run all the way out there and get lined up on them.
Testaverde had the Seminoles looking both directions.
Robinson lines up to the left. There's a low center snap. He's blocked again. Diving into the end zone. Touchdown, Florida State. I don't believe it. Seminoles blocked 2 in a row.
Jeff figures to be one of the best games of the weekend. Live Saturday at 7:30 Eastern Time, it'll be South Carolina, the Gamecocks going against Bobby Bowden and his Florida State Seminoles. Bobby Bowden knows full well the importance of this weekend's game for his Seminoles.
This week's ball game we've got to have. If you plan on getting a bowl bid, you better not drop one now. It is definitely better to lose the first part of the year than it is the last part of the year, because everybody's got you all lined up in the last part of the year. Then you lose one, you drop out. We cannot afford to lose the next two ball games.
I think it's real important. South Carolina beat us last year, and they beat us up pretty bad down in their hometown. And, you know, that was a tough game. It was one of those games that you want to win because it's a big game, it's big bowls, riding on a victory. And we lost that game, and, you know, like I said, they beat us pretty handily. It's going to be a hard-fought football game again this week.
It's a tie ball game if they can kick the extra point.
I think it's very important for us because we're 4-4. We're coming off a tough loss, and we need to have a great game to build our confidence back up.
I guess you could say it's the most important game of the season because we're at a turning point right now. We're 4-4. We're playing 500 football, and we'd really like to get over the hump and
get on the winning track and stay on the winning track for the remainder of the season. I think these last three ball games are probably more important to us than any games ever have been, because we want to have a bowl game. And I realize that our chances of that are not that great right now, but we still feel like if we can come away with three wins here, that we still have an outside chance.
Buddy,
you know, I think we're fired up now. I think everybody had to get it out of their heads. I think in the beginning of the week it was still in everybody's heads that they were thinking Miami, you know, the defeat and everything. But now I think everybody's forgotten the Miami game and they're getting fired up for this game.
College football these days for the big football powers really amounts to three different seasons. Number one, the first part of the season. Number two, November, when all the bowl bids go out. And then if you make a bowl game, the bowl season is still another completely different season. Bobby Bowden knows full well the Seminoles cannot afford another loss. For South Carolina, this has been somewhat of a disappointing season for Joe Morrison and his Chargers. They can certainly wipe out a lot of that taste of disappointment with a victory on Saturday night. You can see that live on our CFA, Saturday Night Football, at 7:30 Eastern Time on Saturday. We're at half.
College football, the Florida State Seminoles have three games remaining on the regular season. The first of those three will go down tomorrow in a 7:45 kick at Doak Campbell Stadium. The opponent is South Carolina, a team which has gone from riches to rags in just one season. We'll hear more from Joe Daggett.
South Carolina is coming off a devastating loss to North Carolina State. A juggling catch and a 75-yard scoring play in the dying seconds caused them to fall to a mediocre team they had led 17-6 late in the contest. Emotionally, it was shattering.
When you lose one like this, it's a gut-wrenching loss, and at some point in time, you've got to be able to put it behind you. I think the kids do it better than coaches.
Last year, the Gamecocks defeated FSU 38-26 in a game in which the Seminoles contributed to their own demise with nine turnovers. But this Carolina team is a far cry from last year's Black Magic ensemble. Scrambling quarterback Mike Hold is back, but the offensive line, which was the real key to the 10-2 season, is gone. The sophomores and juniors now playing are said to have talent, but they've shown little sign of maturing into a consistent unit. Hold has spent a lot of time running for his life this year, and the running backs often don't get out of their tracks. The defense is small up front, but has improved as the year's gone on. It played well enough to win against NC State, but it desperately needs help from the offense in keeping the ball away from the Seminoles.
Well, we basically know that their offense is very explosive, and usually they're going to get their points, and we're going to have to score some and control the ball.
Dendy is the only regular among the running backs who's fully healthy right now. Three ball carriers are doubtful for FSU with ankle injuries, and another smashed a knee last Saturday and is lost for the season. Thinned ranks are another reason realists in South Carolina feel the Gamecocks face long odds in Tallahassee. Joe Daggett in Columbia for Channel 6 Eyewitness Sports.
ESPN CFA football, as the Gamecocks of South Carolina are at Florida State. The Seminoles must win to keep their hopes alive for a bowl game. Here's more in this report from Mark Feinberg.
Break out your book of cliches and look up the following. What comes around goes around. It's payback time, the revenge factor, and teams looking to get back on the righteous road to victory. All of the above are applicable in this weekend's ESPN national telecast of the Florida State-South Carolina game. These two teams are hurting after suffering losses last Saturday, and they need a win to soothe their fans and their soul.
Both of us will find out a lot about what kind of kids we got, you know, because kids could take, and the thing I worry about my players is I don't want them lingering on that loss to Miami. They got to get that one behind them. That's history. Not one thing we can do about it, and put everything on the next opponent, which is South Carolina. And South Carolina's got to do the same thing. If we don't, somebody can get in trouble.
Last week's game for South Carolina was a game of what ifs. What if, with less than a minute remaining, Thomas Dendy had scored on this screen pass? Or what if Eric Poole had been in bounds when he caught this pass? For Florida State, their game against Miami was an example of what gave in: the FSU secondary. And the Canes' Vinny Testaverde was doing all the taking. That old black magic has disappeared this season for the Gamecocks, which is evident by their 4-4 record.
If we had it. Chance to have a great year that we needed to win one of those ball games against Michigan, against Georgia, or against Pittsburgh, and we came out of there 0-3, and then of course last weekend we gave up a couple big plays right at the end of the ball game, North Carolina State, and they came back and beat us 21-17. So you know, we're 4-4 at this particular point, and the last three games of the football season are very important to us.
In conclusion, these two teams are looking to make amends for past mistakes. In Tallahassee, Mark Feinberg for ESPN.
So it's South Carolina, Florida State, live 7:30 Eastern Time tonight on ESPN. Other matchup coming up.
And fill the sky with garnet and gold. Proceeds from balloon sales go to help the ROTC. And the balloons are sponsored by WCTV and your area McDonald's. Do your part to make it a really big show when the Noles are on the warpath.
And we'll have a final word here about how good.
The story of this one, Cannon play of the game, tailback Victor Floyd goes 61 yards down the right sideline for the sixth Seminole TD of their nine of the game. That made the score 42-7. FSU went on to win it. And now this from Cannon on our play of the game.
The College Football Report has been brought to you by the Hartford, the insurance people, TT.
It's time for...
And appropriately enough, the senior scored the first touchdown. Hassan Jones slants across the middle. At this point, 10-zip FSU. Keith Ross injured his ankle tonight. Don't know how serious it is at this point, but he sure looked good on this play. 23-yard touchdown run. Nose led 19-zip at half. Time to talk to Burt Reynolds.
It was great to see those guys today. It was very emotional for me, and it was terrific. There was 20-some of them back, 27 of them back here.
Real quickly, last night, did you get any sleep?
Last night, I didn't sleep a wink. I know I looked that way. I don't care. I was so happy to be with those guys. I'll never laugh so hard in my life.
What a super guy. What a crazy second half. Tony Smith fumbles, picks it up. Whatever, it works. 20-yard pickup, 6 fumbles by FSU tonight. They recovered all but 2. John Iannotta and Jamie Dukes abuse the smaller Catamount defensive lineman. Tony Smith takes it in for the score, 26-0. Now here's a nice play. Chip Ferguson, getting better at avoiding the blitz, throws a low pass behind Hassan. The senior makes the grab. Time for another touchdown, counter option, the pitch to Ross. He is stronger than the other guy. That's quite obvious. Catamounts were ready to try just about anything tonight. The reverse, followed by the pass, followed by an interception by Jesse Solomon, another senior coming through. That kind of night for Western Carolina. Let's check the final score right now. FSU 50, Western Carolina 10. The Noles are now 8-2. Michael, again, not much of a contest.
Homecoming winners this evening over Western Carolina. Bob Warren is standing by. Homecoming happiness, rather, at Florida State tonight, where the Seminoles put on one heck of a show for the alums. The Tribe big winners is expected over Western Carolina. Bob Warren is standing by live at Doe Campbell Stadium with all the particulars. Bob? Campbell Stadium. We'll try to get back up with Bob in a few moments. First off, the picture not so rosy out at Bragg Stadium tonight. 50-10 over Western Carolina out of Doe Campbell Stadium. Let's pick up some of the highlights from this evening tonight. Florida State gets on the board first. Derek Schmidt kicking a 35-yard field goal in the first, and it was 3-0 Florida State. Freshman quarterback Chip Ferguson looking strong. He hits Hassan Jones on this 14-yard pass. It makes it 1st and 10 for Florida State from the 8th. But that's not enough. Ferguson one more time. There's Hassan Jones, a big senior, playing his last home game at Doe Campbell Stadium. 10-0 Seminoles leading now. Ferguson once again is going to spy Darren Holloman, the swifty wide receiver from Leon High School. Holds it in 47 yards downfield. That set up a Keith Ross touchdown from 22 yards away. Point after failed, and Florida State led 16-0. Western Carolina, not too much of a threat all evening long. Right here, quarterback Edwards picked off by Eric Williams. That would lead eventually to a Florida State field goal. Derek Schmidt, and it's 19-0 Seminoles on top. Great run coming up here by Tony Smith, another senior, the senior from Miami, his final game at Doe Campbell Stadium. He's going to get the ball, a pitch from Ferguson. He drops it. Oh, my. Picks up the hot potato. He's going to go 31 yards with it, Will Smith. A couple plays later, he takes it in for the score. It's 26-0 Florida State. Keith Ross would add another rushing touchdown. Seminoles keeping it on the ground. That made it 33-0 Seminoles. One more time, Chuck Wells up and over. It's 40-0. Western Carolina did not get on the board until late in the game. Eric Thomas is picked off. The Western Carolina defender will take it the distance, 70 yards. That would be their only touchdown on the game. The Seminoles went on to a big 50-10 victory tonight over Western Carolina at Doe Campbell Stadium. One of the big alums on hand this evening was Burt Reynolds, the former Florida State footballer, on hand to help in some pregame festivities honoring longtime trainer Don Faulds, who is retiring after 27 years of service. Bob Warren talked with Burt Reynolds at halftime.
Bert, always good to see you. Welcome back to Tallahassee and welcome
home.
Thank
you. It's a great time to be here with Rooster getting this award. I think it's just wonderful, and I hate to see him retire. I think it's an end of an era.
25 years, 300 games, you've been friends throughout, haven't you?
He was the first guy that I really became friends with when I was here. And, of course, if you wore as much tape as I did when you played, you had to be friends with the trainer.
Tell us about your relationship with Doc. It's funny. We interviewed him yesterday. He seemed to be a little nervous, almost to the point of tears. So I'm saying to everybody, watch Doc. He's going to crack up tonight. He'll never make it through. I'm watching you. I thought you were going to cry.
Well, it was an emotional evening for both of us. But when he got in the car, he did cry.
Did he really?
Yes, on the way back to the locker room. And then Bobby wanted me to introduce him to the players tonight, and I did. And he never made it through the speech.
I know you're also here for another reason, and that is the reunion of the Sun Bowl team of 1955.
Yeah, it's shocking that many years have gone by, because I was only 11 years old when I played, and it's hard to be with all those guys. We were all checking each other out last night to see, you know, how many glasses we had and what we were doing. And, you know, after this many years, instead of talking about our relationships with women, we're talking about how many operations we've had.
Listen, it's always great to see
you. Thank you very much.
And welcome home, I say.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Give my love to your wife.
I will.
Okay.
And Burt Reynolds. Well, if you take your breakfast on the 8-2 record after last night's whopping win over Western Carolina, the Seminoles now have a week off before facing the Gators in Gainesville on the 30th. Next week may be idle on the field, but it will not be in the office. At exactly 6 p.m. on Saturday, bowl bids are extended. The Seminoles are rumored to be heading to either the Gator Bowl in Jacksonville or the Cherry Bowl in Pontiac, Michigan. Last night, Bobby Bowden was having nothing to do with the speculation.
Gator Bowl said your number one choice. Cherry Bowl wants you real bad.
I won't touch that one with a 10-foot pole.
Do you have any preference to go to the North or stay in Florida?
Do I have a preference?
Yeah.
I won't touch that one with a 10-foot pole. You know the answer. No, I wouldn't say. Sure, I have a preference.
I think the bottom line is trying to get into a bowl that would best project your football team.
Darryl Waltrip.
Hey everybody, break out your chisel and get ready to carve this in granite. Florida State is going to the Gator Bowl, period. The decision has been made, the die has been cast, it's academic. Eyewitness Sports has learned that the Tribe will make its second appearance in 4 years and fourth overall to the Gator Bowl on December 30th. Their acceptance is the only formality standing in the way. And that will come Saturday night at 6 o'clock on Pick'em Day, when bowl officials can officially extend their bids. A member of the Gator Bowl committee told me the Seminoles are the bowl's first choice, and obviously vice versa. FSU's last appearance was on December 30th, 1982, when the Tribe muscled West Virginia 31-12. The Allens, Greg, and Billy had great games. Billy returned this kickoff 98 yards for the touch, and Greg rushed for 138 yards and two touchdowns. The Gator Bowl will net Florida State nearly $900,000 and will be televised nationally by ABC. Now to the probable opponents, all from the Big Eight. It'll either be the loser of the Oklahoma-Nebraska game or the Oklahoma State Cowboys. Florida State officials are still playing it close to the vest, but do openly acknowledge that they'll do their holiday bowling very close to home. The Gator Bowl news comes on the heels of one of the wildest and busiest weekends in recent memory. It was homecoming at Florida State. And folks, these Seminoles do know how to throw a wing ding.
Homecoming is simply out of this world.
In Tallahassee.
And speaking of out of this world, there's an old Seminole.
Norm Thagard flying in from Mission Control.
Don Falls is stepping down after over 300 games.
A great trainer.
And who's staying with Don this weekend? It's good old what's-his-name.
Hi, Bert.
Come on, let's start the parade. There's football to be played.
First got a legend, the 55 Sun Bowl. Now no further delay.
Play ball.
The Catamounts are overmatched, but the Seminoles start off slow.
Take three.
Second quarter, Chip Ferguson.
What a catch by Darren Holloman, 47 yards.
Keith Frost takes it 22, FSU is in charge.
Ouch. Tony Smith then demonstrates a little basketball finesse. Tony scores a little later on, that's blocking at its best.
Keith Frost then takes it in, the lead is 33. The game was fine, but the homecoming celebration.
This could be your dream house, but it could fade in a snap.
So 2-5. Michigan, Oklahoma State, the Bruins of UCLA, Auburn, and the Air Force are numbers 6 through 10. Ohio State's the leader of the second pack. Florida State jumps two clicks to 12th. Then you have BYU, Baylor, Tennessee, Arkansas, LSU, Texas A&M, Texas, and Arizona State. The Washington Redskins have suffered a crippling injury. Everybody, the Washington Redskins are no longer dead skins. They are alive and well and back in the race for the NFC East title. However, they'll have to travel the rest of this rocky road without their leader, Joe Theismann, after he was injured in the second quarter last night against the New York Giants. And I'm telling you, this is a painful thing to see. Lawrence Taylor on the blitz in one of those freak plays. He falls on Theismann's right leg and bends it nearly in half. As you can see, Taylor knew what had happened and was plainly upset. They operated on Theismann's compound fracture, but he will be off that leg completely for 6 months. Still, the Redskins hung tough, though, and gave themselves a chance to win it with two straight onside kick recoveries, this one by Greg Williams. And that set the table for Theismann's replacement rookie, Jay Schrader, to hit Clint Didier from 14 yards out. You're watching the game winner, folks, as the Redskins take it by two. Theismann, the oldest starting quarterback in the NFL, is definitely out for the rest of the year. And at age 36, the compound fracture may well end his career.
In a split second, a trick play blew up in Joe Theismann's face. Crushed by Giants defenders, the quarterback's right leg snapped just above the ankle.
There are two bones in this shin, right at the level where his socks were, about the junction between the middle third of the bone and the distal third of the bone. The bone was broken. It was crushed on the side away from his body. Approximately half of the diameter of the bone was crushed, or comminuted, as we'd say. And the part of the bone closest to his hip side penetrated through the skin and then came back into the wound.
Theismann was brought here to Arlington Hospital, where team physician Dr. Charles Jackson set the bones in emergency surgery. While a compound fracture is serious, the doctor says this injury is less severe than most knee injuries in terms of rehabilitation. This is the first major injury Theismann has suffered in a brilliant 12-year career. In fact, he had started 71 consecutive games, the longest streak among active NFL quarterbacks. But now, age 36 and nursing two broken bones, one wonders if Joe Theismann will come back.
The college football hit parade
shocked the state of Minnesota to fulfill an ambition. It seems so many dream of the Notre Dame job, but few are chosen, and Holtz is 25th on the list. As for anticipating the pressure that comes with the territory,
I don't know. I'm just going to be myself. I'm, you know, Notre Dame hired me, obviously, because they like certain things about me, and I'm going to try to be myself. And we're going to have adversity, and this isn't going to be a marriage. And I'm not looking at Newt Rockne's record or Leahy's record or Eric Parsegian's record. I looked at that, I thought that was a misprint. I don't see how anybody can win that many football games and lose that few. I just want to do the best I can, and I hope that I can add to the tradition of Notre Dame.
Nobody asked, but Holtz also paid tribute to the man he replaced, Jerry Faust, and applauded his display of character under fire. So it's a new beginning at Notre Dame. Lou Holtz, outgoing, witty, and who, as he's put it, works from dawn to exhaustion, has landed in South Bend, Indiana. He brings unbridled enthusiasm and a lot of high hopes with him.
And two of them are about to earn their hardest dollars of the season. Come Saturday, the annual neighborhood squabble, Florida State and Florida, happens again. This will be round number 28 in the ongoing heavyweight championship of the Sunshine State. And Rick Carley now tells us what the players are thinking.
I don't want to go home and have another miserable Christmas and having all my friends say, why did Florida beat you? Why did Florida beat you? This really wanted to change.
A loss is like losing to your sister in a game of one-on-one basketball. It leaves a bad taste in your mouth that you'd rather not discuss. That's the feeling of players from both teams regarding this weekend's game. These emotions giving birth during the two schools' recruiting wars.
A lot of players on both schools might have turned Florida down to go to Florida State, might have turned Florida State down to come to Florida. So I think you have that going for you, that that you want to go out and prove to everyone that you did select the right school.
No player on the FSU team has ever beaten Florida. The Gators go after their fifth win in a row on Saturday in what Florida players feel is the game of the year.
You may think Auburn, Georgia, maybe Miami are big rivalries for the Gators. That they are, but not nearly as big, according to Coach Hall, as Florida State.
I think it's very important to the team that wins this, and they'll go hold their heads up very highly after this game.
We want to, you know, go out with a win. Our seniors have been so successful here, they want to go out on a good note, and I think they'll be, you know, come up with some good plays, and they'll be the leaders Saturday.
The Seminoles, meanwhile, are ready to stop the Gator streak.
even if it takes an attitude that approaches...
I don't know if it's nasty. It's semi-nasty, I guess you could say.
It's not a big, let's go out and, you know, win the game. It's let's go out and beat the Gators.
The schools this year sport the best combined record in the history of the series. So no doubt the winner earning legitimate off-season bragging rights. Rick Carley for the Florida News Network.
Of course, Florida Field has been sold out, has been for some time. Your only shot at seeing this classic live is at the Leon County Civic Center. The box office will be open on Friday. That's your last chance to purchase tickets at reduced prices.
Rushing only three men.
Scholarship funds in memory of this one play, which was, of course, the game-winning field goal by Van Tiffin. Remember, earlier this season, Tiffin missed a 60-yarder on the last play of a 16-14 loss to Tennessee. If he'd made that one, the Crimson Tide would be going to the Sugar Bowl. But this was a dramatic clutch kick, and Doug Flutie, it came at the tail end of a series of dramatic plays.
Unbelievable.
He won that game for the fifth consecutive time, 38-14. The former walk-on quarterback, who may someday be a Heisman candidate himself, Kerwin Bell, had three touchdown passes and has already passed Steve Spurrier on the career list at Florida with a total of 37 in his career. Neil Anderson went over 1,000 yards for the year. We'll be back with more right after this. Games from Saturday, Florida rolled over Florida State, the final 38-14. Kerwin Bell, 14 of 22, 343 yards, three TDs. That's 21 on the year. Running back Neil Anderson also had 95 yards rushing. Florida wins over Florida State convincingly. Galen Hall is now 17-1-1 since taking over there. Florida, of course, will be going nowhere because of their probation. It's their fifth straight win over Florida State.
But I want you to know
Florida football with Galen Hall has been brought to you by Atlantic Bank, Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Florida, Dairy Farmers Incorporated, Farm Credit Service of Florida, your Florida and South Georgia Ford dealers, Gatorade Thirst Quencher, Likes Beats, Scotty's, SeaWorld, Sonny's Real Pit Barbecue, and by Whirlpool. Listen to the Gator Hotline with Galen Hall Show, Wednesday nights from 7:07 till 8 p.m. on the Gator Radio Network. Promotional consideration by Gordon's Jewelers. Gordon's features Longines, the world's most honored watch, including the Longines Wittenauer. Gordon's fine jewelry stores from coast to coast, with 48 throughout Florida. And by His Stores for Men, featuring Jordache jeans. You have got the look that's right with Jordache.
Share a little bit of...
Snipes hit rock bottom today. The former Florida State running back was busted this afternoon in West Palm Beach and charged with possession and sale of cocaine to undercover agents. All this while resisting arrest without violence. The arrest happened at 1:50 when, according to police reports, the Palm Beach Tactical Anti-Drug Unit took Snipes into custody after the drug transaction was completed. He's in the Palm Beach County Jail tonight. You know, few players who ever wore the garnet and gold had more talent than Snipes. Desire, though, was strictly another matter. He was constantly in Bobby Bowden's doghouse, suspended, reprimanded, and finally withdrew from school this past summer because of academic problems. But it looked as if everything would work out fine for Snipes. He was selected in a special NFL draft by the San Francisco 49ers and then signed to a very handsome and lucrative contract. He was scheduled to report to the Niners training camp next summer. A big kick in the grass got underway in Tallahassee. Will continue. Jones says he will remain in semi-lovely Stillwater and forsake the top coaching job at Pitt. Jones was Pittsburgh's top choice to replace Foz Fazio, who was dismissed a couple of weeks back. Add another All-American honor to the glittering resume of Florida State's Jamie Dukes. The senior guard was named to the UPI second team All-America squad today. He's already been selected to the AP Walter Camp and Kodak teams. And after 12 days of rest and recuperation from the Florida game, the Seminole football team goes back to work tomorrow preparing for the Gator Bowl game. They'll meet Pat Jones's Oklahoma State Cowboys on December 30th. The first college football bowl game of the season takes place this Saturday night. It's the California Bowl. That could only mean Christmas is not all that far away. But before we look ahead and try to figure out who's going to win the national championship, let's pause and take a look back at the year in college football.
June, in New Orleans, the nation's college presidents vote in new, harsher penalties for teams that cheat. For Florida, the old penalties were tough enough. One of the nation's best teams kicked off the year with no hope of a bowl game. The Gators were on probation. Shortly after, another scandal, this at Texas Christian University. In all, seven players admitted taking money. All of them, including star running back Kenneth Davis, kicked off the team. There were only two teams that ended unbeaten and untied. One was Bowling Green. The other, Penn State. Top rank going into the bowls, the national title belongs to Joe Paterno if the Lions beat Oklahoma. But if Oklahoma wins, then Miami can claim number one if it wins the Sugar Bowl. But the Hurricanes may end up only splitting the national title with the Sooners, despite the fact Miami beat Oklahoma in Norman by 13 points. For Eddie Robinson, the top came when his Grambling Tigers beat Prairie View A&M. The win pushed Robinson past Bear Bryant and made him the all-time winningest coach in college football history. While Robinson rode high, Foz Fazio rode out of town, fired by Pittsburgh. But it was the final year of Jerry Faust that commanded our attention. Notre Dame fumbled its way through a losing season. Faust resigned before the final game, replaced by Lou Holtz. For Liberty University in Virginia, there were no games at all after a flood swamped their complex. Which leaves us with this play by South Carolina quarterback Mike Hold as our play of the year. The Gamecocks were routed by Pitt in this game, but Hold hooked up on a freaky TD pass. Unfortunately for South Carolina fans, this touchdown may have been the highlight of their year as well.
What a season.
Yancey SUTV, Channel 11, in Tallahassee, Florida.
Funding for the production of this program is provided in part here tomorrow by Killarn Realty.
Well, I've got two thoughts about the 85 season. One, very disappointed that we lost three real big games. The Auburn game, the Miami game, and the Florida game. Very disappointing. And then at the same time, looking at it from an overall standpoint, I can see how far the program has come. That here we are, an 8-3 football team, and catching a lot of criticism about not having a good year. That is a good sign, because when I first came here, 8-3 would have satisfied everybody.
Now, offensively, men, listen to what we need to do offensively. Run left. Run right. Reverse left. Reverse right. And throw the ball, because that fatigues the opponent. So if we can make those things go at all, man, we'll get them out of gas. You know, they'll have a hard time rushing that passer. So offense, that's what we're thinking about now. Quarterbacks, now don't forget, Danny, first half, I don't mind using my timeouts. So if I'm late with a call, when we're down inside that 20, you know, if there's any confusion at all, remember last week on the 34, there's a little confusion on the way we sent it in. But you can use a timeout down there. I'd rather have the touchdown than saving the timeout. Men, now listen to me. Listen to what I say. That's very important. Don't worry about a mistake. You young guys, you worry about mistakes. Don't worry about a mistake. If you're going to make it, how are you going to make it? Full speed.
TV people have not been down to tell us what the time is.
Okay, and that's what we'll go on?
Oh, got to.
Okay, so y'all let me know if you hear any adjustment. I'm going to keep mine like it is.
We're going to have two people.
Because I'm ahead of y'all.
We're going to have two people. If our people come over.
Good deal.
With the TV people, if there's any change, we'll let you know.
Right.
But they control us.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I know it does, too.
I'm just going to ask you one question, and I'm going to go on and check with you.
All right.
Everybody clipping and going to the room?
Yeah.
John, do you need me to stay?
Well, a couple of things I need to mention to you. We will shovel pass. Yes, sir, and we might drop that ball on the ground, but it's a pass. It ain't no problem if you're enough. Also, we will go on no snap, on no cadence. We'll just pull the ball and take off with no snap count.
Okay.
At any time.
They're all set.
They're set. We ain't going to say nothing.
And they won't be down to 3-point then,
right? No, we're going to go up stance some.
As long as they're set.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Be set. Then we just like to mention about them, high block, low block. On the offense, their offensive line against our defense.
Chop block.
Yeah, and then they leg whip the heck out of you when you get away from them.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a couple of things that we like to do. But I want you to know about our shovel, in case we do.
And I'm glad you mentioned that other about that going fast, because that sometimes we don't look.
Actually, we won't go down. We won't come out of a huddle fast. It's just that we will pull the ball.
I know, but I mean,
but it's still, exactly.
We don't want to blow anything on you.
No. Good luck, though. Okay, buddy, thank you.
Together now, baby. Y'all can do it. Y'all good as anybody in the country. Who won the toss? We won it. Good second. Good job, baby. Good job. Let's go do it, baby. Let's do it now. Get you good, Johnny. Come on, y'all. Good job. Come on, man. Let's go do it now. Come on, baby. Come on out. What did they do on third down? What coverage on third down? Huh? Now, hold on. Let me get that. 4-3, huh? So we could run 68 scatter. 4-68. They're running a lot of 4-3.
Right.
So we can run 4-68 scatter.
Okay.
Get you a good deep drop. We'll run Y out of there. We'll run Y out of there. And then we'll bring those Z back in that dang middle, see?
Okay.
Where's little man? You get back deep now and buy time on it. We're going to run a scatter on these guys in a minute.
Okay.
We'll catch a running man here.
Okay. Like, he's running man. He's back, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so, you want me to go up 6?
Not yet.
You want me to pause?
Drive down, just kind of slow. He's doing it now. Run him in the middle.
Okay. So
okay.
Really no pause.
Well, just got to go down there and try to hold it. Just get in there and open, okay?
Running backs of the pro set. McManus spins around, wants to run the option. Fires. Catch. Tolman. Touchdown, Florida State.
Who's it on?
Carrying by Cletus Jones.
Hey, who's in the ball game? Hey, get your formation right.
Pablo, we got a block for 4 seconds.
Five, Kevin.
Come on. Four.
Second down or what?
David.
Okay, I want, where's my?
I got you.
Louis, 94 shovel. What down? Is it second or first?
First down. 24 yards.
is it, Mr. Hump?
Second down.
Yeah.
Conditioning is going to be a factor. You guys, with Hurricane Helene, you practiced inside for 11 days, and you opened last weekend indoors. Can you hold up strong in the fourth quarter?
We're in the briar patch. This is our kind of weather.
One other question. When you went out there on the little shuffle pass, did they know that it was a shuffle pass until you told them?
I told them before the ball game we're going to throw that thing, and it's an incomplete pass. And I've been darned, I thought they awarded it to them.
Well, so, they did it first.
Yeah, well, they got corrected right quick.
All right, Bobby. Good luck.
Thank you, Tim. Now, we got to be together to win this dadgum game. Now, let's go over some things. Listen to me. Defense. If they don't score, we win. And we do want to win, right? All right, hold it. If they don't score, we got it. Now, listen, they're tired. You are too, but they're twice as tired. We need to take the kickoff and drive it for a touchdown. I think we got them. If you'll keep hitting. Now, offense, let's get that kick out of there. Might be kicking with the wind. If I had a tailbacks, if you'd be fierce, we'd go run up and down the field. If you were a fierce thing, you could run up and down the field. We're opening holes up there. Get it there and go to the goal line with a dead gum ball. I don't need him a fancy damning. Oh, one of you tailbacks ought to tear it up. If you'll protect our passer offensive line, hell, everybody's getting wide open. That Cadillac was wide open, and you let them get to our passer. Protect them. Make the running. The offense, we need to make the running game go. Backs, don't fumble. A fumble will kill us. No fumbles. A great kicking game. A great kicking game. That's the key. Now, men, listen to me. Y'all have worked hard, and you are better than Nebraska. You are better than Nebraska. Now, listen to what I say. Are we going to let them beat us? Let's get out there and get on. Hurry. Let me say something to Tom here. Tom, good
luck, Bobby.
Thank you, buddy. Good luck to you, pal.
Very well.
That game helped us a lot. Take care of yourself, Thomas.
Congratulations.
Good job. Yeah. Hey, great job, my boy. I'm proud of you. Hey, you guys did it. Yeah. Okay, Tim.
We're going to get off here.
Okay,
hey, you came to the Briar Patch and you did it.
Yeah, you're dang right. Thank you, buddy. Take care, Seth. Good job, Bill.
Good game, coach.
Thank you, buddy. Good job.
Get out of here, fellas. Woo. Congratulations,
man. Thank you, boy. Y'all mighty nice. Thank you, man. Y'all mighty great. Thank you. Thank you, buddy. Oh, my legs are fixing to pump up. That's what I'm saying. That's getting better, baby. Now, men, last week, somebody told you there ain't no free lunches and wrote it on the board, and boy, how important that was. This game is not going to be a free lunch. This will be, I guarantee you, they are a well-coached football team that are going to be a bunch of tigers if you'll let them. If you'll let them. In other words, show them that you're a pushover, and I guarantee you they'll turn tigers, and they'll not tie us this time. They'll whip us. Now, don't let that happen. I'm talking about go out there on the first play and knock the crap out of them now. Clean. I talk about playing mean, but I do not want dirty football. But, man, that's what makes you different from those students out there. You're tougher. You're tougher. And it's legal to hit out there. Just don't get penalties. Offense, now the first play of the game. 7, waggle, Z, post. I want it to look exactly like a run. Lineman, when you get your assignment, make it aggressive like you're really blocking for the run. Fullbacks, attack. Tailback, make a great fake and make them think you've got the ball. Quarterback, let them see you give him the football. Then hide it and get back and let's throw the Z post. Now, men, I'm not doing that to loosen them up. I want a touchdown. But if they do happen to play it, at least we get that safety out of the ball game. Then our square ends and everything, I think, will be pretty good later on in the game. But let's do a good job on that and get it, huh? Another thing on that bound risky, don't be in a hurry to drop. It looks like a pass. Just hop slow, I get for line. Listen here, just make you a good fake, and then let's get that post here. Let's see if we get a touchdown. Don't worry about it if it's an incident. Don't worry about nothing. Okay. Just have a good time, all right?
All right.
Next play, we'll probably come back with 84 or 344 Z corner.
Miscue. McManus, play fake, drops back, pressure coming. He's going to be sacked and loses the football. Being assisted to his feet. Gets a nice round of applause. And walks over a little groggily for the Seminole.
Missed. You check that wind here. I believe it's... Dang, Watts coming this way. Now she's going that way. So you'll check it real good.
Right.
But if we win the toss, we'll take the second half option.
Right.
Now, if they want to receive, then you find out which way that wind's blowing, we'll kick that way.
All right.
Now, if they win it, we'll receive the football. And then the second half, we'll decide where that wind is and
all
defend
right.
it.
So if they take the ball and we get the choice, then you want the win on the kickoff.
If they
win the toss and they say we would like to receive,
then you find that win. Yes, sir. Get that win. Yeah, we'll kick with the win.
Kick with the win.
I know it. That's what I know. It has. It's changed.
All right. Well, we
want that win all the time. Yeah.
All right. So you like it in the first and the third quarters?
Well, yeah. No, I like it first, second, third, fourth. I want it every quarter.
Let's talk to the man. We get a switch like that.
But if I got a kickoff, I never want to kick off into the wind.
Right. Yes, sir.
So in third, you want to get it out there and get you a good start.
All right. Yeah.
L 344. Let's go.
Here comes.
Hey, coach, get somebody. We popped.
I didn't call swap last time. I called over.
Should we run the plays that we can afford to stay? Men, I want you to play real clean, but aggressive. Real clean, but boy, you're going to... I know what Auburn thinks. They think they'll out-hit those Seminoles. They think they'll out-hit those beach boys. Those guys from the beaches, they'll out-hit them. You see? So let's us be sure we out-hit them. Now, on the first play of the game, show that guy what a tough day he's going to have. Hey, man, you want to go through this for 60 minutes? Because this is what you're going to catch every down. And let him have it. Now, listen to me. Make Bo Jackson take himself out of the ball game like he did against Tennessee. The coaches didn't take him out. He said, coaches, I'm not going back in. My leg hurts. Well, he might have said my leg smarts. I'm not sure which one. But he wouldn't go back. Now, men, make him take himself out again. And that ain't going to come easy. He's got to know that he's going through 60 minutes of hell if he stays out there. Now, if we don't do that, he can get us. Hey, Coach, I called it. What happened on that? I called it. I wanted to throw it in the sideline. What happened?
I called it like you said it, Coach.
Well, I wonder why he's...
He just...
Where is it? What's it down? Second eight? Okay, this will be a right bomber. Right bomber. Get little man. Get little man. Right bomber.
Second and goal at the Auburn 8.
This is the second down. Now, Wayne, if we don't make it, see what's there on this play. See if 60 goal line. Z reverse pass to the quarterback. No, R, 46Z reverse pass to the quarterback.
Third and goal.
To the quarterback. Now, you got Hassan Z? Now, I hope X will fly there now. Third down, right? He's out here, and that you guess he's all right?
Said, you all right? He said, well, I'm all right. He said, I'm just a little dizzy. I got hit out there.
No, we can't afford to lose a game.
I know it.
What do you think? He's blown formation.
He blew one formation, then he fumbled a snap. Other than that, everything's all right. Let's give one more series.
Well, you keep your eye on him. Yes, I mean, it's important here we don't play this ball game.
Right.
Dad, you think you're okay, huh, buddy?
I think so.
It's very important now, if you're not, to be honest with me.
I will. I'll let you know.
Is Eric Thomas. Defense, keep pounding. You're playing great. Defense, if they don't score anymore, we ain't gonna lose. But offense, you gotta get some points on the board to win. Men, let's have a man, it's just strictly down to guts. They got 30 minutes to go. We got 30 minutes to go. If it's fourth down and one here, let's get a Bowden Rooster. If it's fourth and one.
Bowden Roosky, Nebraska and some other people in the past have used trick plays they call boomer rooskies, as I've heard. And so a couple of years ago, I was going to put in a play based off of a boomer rooskie. And when you're the head football coach and you put in plays like that, your coaches all kind of turn their head and laugh, you know, which I used to do when I was assistant. See, you're nearly ashamed to approach them with it. And so I've stuck my name on it, and said, told my coaches and the players, if it don't work, I'm the guy that's to blame. Y'all don't have to take the blame for it. So if it fails, you can say, hey, that's Byron Roos. That's his play. That dummy put that thing in. So we just started calling it that. And so now then, anytime we use the term Byron Rooski or Rooski, our kids know that some kind of a play, a gimmick type of a play to take advantage of something that the other team's doing. That if it backfires, you look stupid. You look like the Three Stooges if it don't work.
Goes to A.G., he's got daylight, there he goes to the 35, down the sideline to the 50, he's going to the 40, giving chases Mayhew will bring him down to the 11. Second down and 12 from there, play fake by Washington, wants to pitch the ball, here's a reverse to Wagand, Wagand's got daylight, he'll almost plant into the end zone, and 8 from the 22, he'll drop back to throw, pressure coming, sets up, cocks the arm, fires, the pass is overthrown, it's picked off by Porter, he's to the 20, to the 15, to the 10, he'll score.
Let him in. Thank you. Too good for us. I tell you, y'all got a good team.
Well,
as everybody thought. You started playing football, is what's happened.
That's
good luck, pretty Pat.
Good luck, buddy.
Same to you. Hey, boy, you and a difference.
If I'd have had you with one, I'll tell you that.
Good job, boy. Excuse me, baby.
Sidelines.
Really?
All I had in my stomach.
Well, so usually the food that you put in don't help you for that game anyway. That's why I guess that's why they hadn't put too much on it. Whereas if you ate the wrong food, you're out there playing a game, your stomach's trying to digest that food, it actually takes away from you. So they're trying to get just enough there to be left. But still, you might need some more. Maybe we're not putting enough in there. I'll make a note and say something to Don about it next time. Okay, buddy. Have you got to go take him in tonight, Bill? shoot. Oh, boy. David, I'll see you tomorrow, pal.
Yes, sir.
What's that, Billy? Got your mouth full, haven't you, baby? It's ESPN or not.
But now we run pass 59Y dump.
Coach Tom Osborne says the action was based on information voluntarily supplied by the players on issues such as, were all four passes given to each player used for fellow students and family members only for a game, or were they used for friends of the family, technically against NCAA regulations? Osborne said, hey, no money changed hands, adding that it looks like cooperating with the NCAA, quote, hasn't resulted in any benefits to anybody that I can see, end of quote. As for how the suspensions could be metered out, Osborne added,
I guess we would be given the option of spreading it out 10 players a game for about six or seven games, but that would be kind of a slow death. You know, you might run the risk of then losing four out of the six or five out of the six, I don't know. So I really don't know. We could do it that way. We could take it all in one lump, or hopefully we'll get a stay. We're expecting to get a stay till next week where we can appeal it to the NCAA Council. We have some encouragement that the NCAA Council might look differently at the situation, but we were totally caught off guard because it wasn't what we had led to believe would happen.
Well, Osborne, of course, got backed up by the school chancellor, Martin Massengale, at the University of Nebraska, said the next move is indeed to appeal that decision of the NCAA's Council Subcommittee on Eligibility Appeals. Massengale went on to say further.
We believe this penalty is excessive, and we are in the process of appealing that decision to the NCAA Council Subcommittee on Eligibility Appeals. We'll have no further comment pending completion of that appeal.
Excessive and unreasonable. Well, what does this all do to the Nebraska schedule? You know they have a game coming up this weekend, rather big one, at home against Florida State. Now, if Osborne, as you heard him talk about, if the penalties stay, would they take everybody out in one game, perhaps pick a Big Eight foe that they might feel they could beat anyway, or will they suspend 10 players at a time and try and get by on a schedule that certainly has a lot of tough teams on it, certainly not all of them as tough as others? This is the decision that the school will have to make, or hopefully, as far as the school is concerned, the NCAA will revoke and rescind its decision to suspend the football players on what seem, on the surface, to be not major infractions. Although with the NCAA interpreting things, who knows? As for Florida State, they're getting prepared to go to Lincoln to play a big football game. What about their football coach, Bobby Bowden? How will this all affect his team?
Number one, I wish it hadn't have happened. Number two, I don't know how to approach it. I'd hate to approach it to my players and say, man, they've lost a bunch of players, and then find out they didn't. They're going to appeal it. Well, I think we got to wait till they appeal it, you know? And so anyway, we'll have to wait to see from that standpoint. But if they do lose those players, from what I understand, he has the option of losing all 60 of them for our game or go ahead and space it out 10 for seven games. And if he did lose them all, then Florida State has got nothing to gain.
Big game, Florida State at Nebraska. Now there's a little bit more around it than just a big early season matchup between two perennial top 20 teams. Greg?
Turning tennis now at the U.S. Open in New York today, a potentially good matchup between top seed Yvonne Lendl and 8th seed Henri Leconte. 10 previous meetings, each had won five times, but Lendl is in the semifinals for the fifth straight year, not so much because he beat Leconte, but because Leconte helped to beat himself. Only 46% of his...
Please, so I can see my distance. Wayne? 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 We could. How much we need? Hey, Wayne, what's. Wayne, I'm just wondering if we should. What we should run here now. We could go for a Z reverse for a touchdown if we don't make it. I know it. But we got to make this thing. They see how much we need? We got a whole yard. From an from a rip? A rip?
Back up, Wayne.
No,
Rip. Timeout. Timeout. Bring your offense over here. Offense. Hey, offense. Come here. Our tie to what?
No gut.
Wayne?
Yep, gut.
Give me the formation. All right, what's the form? Our tie over. And what are we going to run? 30, 51 gut? Hey, men.
Listen, you got
to get it. Now, listen. The whole game is riding on that yard right there. We have got to make it. Huh, son?
Daniel?
We got to make it, man. We got that whole thing. Fullback. You got to get it here. You can do it, baby. Now, all you want to do is take the ball and look it in, okay? Man, we got to make it. We got to make it. Let's go. Hey, Tommy! Tommy! Watch the spot now! Watch him off sides!
We got a good spot, coach.
I can't believe that spot!
Hey, what kind of spot? Hey, Tommy! Hey, what kind of spot was that? That dang guy there.
He was up on the line.
He was all the way on the line a while ago.
I think we got it.
Wayne, what play? Now, this one, we're just about in field goal range now. Hey, no penalty.
I get on them pretty good sometimes. I really do, and all coaches do. Might not be as people might not be as aware of it, but no, I'm gonna stay on those guys pretty good because remember, they make a bad call, it affects my life, it affects my job. You know, I've had calls blown. 1980, when we lost a national championship by one measly point, the only touchdown that was scored on us was a 50-yard pass in our end zone on a 3rd and 18. On an uncatchable pass where interference was called against us, put the ball on the one, and we lose the game by 1 point. Only touchdown the team scored. So it's very important that they call plays fairly. They're going to miss some, you know. And so we're going to stay on them. We're going to stay on them pretty good about it. They know they're going to wear that shirt. They're going to have to be able to stand. They got to stand a little heat too.
Did that look like interference, y'all? Hey up! Hey, what in the world's wrong? That's ridiculous. I cannot believe our officials would sit there and let them do that right there.
Okay, I didn't see that.
I didn't see the darn mess.
I wasn't.
Don't you look at it. I know you were. It wasn't your call.
All right, come on, coach.
I can't believe that last call.
Come on. We can't afford another.
I know it. You're exactly right. Hey, Tommy Rawls! Hey, Tommy! Tommy, they're holding!
Yep.
Hey, Tommy Rose! Hey, Tommy! Let up the little hold!
Come on, Dennis, go deep! What's the hold on?
I feel so guilty. Huh?
That is.
Hey,
not good. Delay. You got. They got a delay on game. We had a delay.
What in the hell are y'all doing? I'm saying, if I call 200 Exxon, if I call red 200 Exxon, will he go Z post or X square in? Yeah. Well, I can't do it out of the R formation then. Well, I want it to look, of course, they'll think it's a pass. All right, so he can go X square in or Z, right? Where's Mark? Mark! Mark! I mean, damn, number five. Where is he?
Chip.
Where's
Chip?
Chip! Get him for me. Chip! Now listen, if we start off with an R, 200, red 200 Exxon, Z post and X square in. So if they're blitz, we get that Z post for touchdown.
out of there. They're killing us on our kickoff return. They brought two of them back on us.
All right, Wayne, if we don't make it, we ought to go for it. All right. We'll fake a punt and go for it. Here. If we don't make it, we'll fake a punt and go for it. John, if we don't make it, we'll fake a punt and go for it. Get him. Punt team. Punt team. What? Did he go on three, you guess?
I was talking to the punt team. You still want the fake punt?
No, it's fourth down.
Okay, I'm talking about.
No, that's third. Hey, Wayne. Let's go for the fake punt if we don't make it.
No. Let's go ahead and kick it. Let's save the fake punt.
All right, fake punt. Fake punt. Red. Red. Fake punt. Fake punt. Fake punt. Fake punt. Fake punt now. You got it?
Yeah, I got it.
Lewis Barry at 24. I mean, right. Get off, Bill.
Carolyn and Kintai deep for the Hurricanes.
Okay, listen to me. This will be. Give me two tights. Give me two tights. R-tight 59 Y post. R-tight. Take a timeout. Take a timeout. Timeout. Hey, Chip. Chip. Timeout. Come here.
You'll cheat over this one.
Are you sure, Coach? Are you sure? We worked on it from two tights.
Both ways. Everybody says R&L is better because it stretches the guy.
Hey, Wayne, is Y post better out of R&L or? Huh?
November the 23rd.
Hey, Jack, where's that safety player? Is he playing over the ball or not? Can we hit him on a stink? No. Nah. Okay, all right, let's step it out.
No.
This is R. It's 59 Y post. You got it? Great fake and come around. Now, if you had any trouble, just throw it out of the end zone. I think it'll be a touchdown. Tell them to protect you like they've never protected you here. Well, they blitz here, Wayne. It's very important now. No? Okay, let's make it now. R pass 59 Y post. Tell them we got to have a touchdown. R. Okay. Now, what down is this? First down or second? Yeah, that's what you. Hey, hold it. No, let him play, folks. I want him chasing X. Get X ready to go here. Hey, Bill, will they blitz us on third down? Will they blitz us on third down? They have? Okay, we'll run them. Oh, man, are they going? Please don't blitz. Man, I thought you fought hard. They made bigger plays when they had to have them. I thought you played hard. When you lose one like this, you got to get it off your mind and get on the next one. Proud of you. Proud of every one of you. You just keep your head up. Let's get out next week and work. Let's win these last two and beat Florida. You fought good. I didn't hip you much. If I could have hipped you a little now, I think we might have won.
Do you know there was an article in the Associated Press, reading on the plane coming down here.
the worst calls ever in the history of college football.
No,
one was Florida, Florida State.
Oh, really? Was that
touchdown?
That
pass.
That awesome, yeah.
You know, the other one was my favorite was Prairie View against Grambling.
Well, that one.
And Prairie View had never won a game, and the guy was running for a touchdown. Grambling won them all. And the guy was running for a touchdown in Grambling, and a guy ran out of the stands with a shotgun and stopped him. And the officials just left the field. And the next day, four police officers walked the official out. He went like this. He was all alone in the whole state. There's nobody around. I went, "You sure there's nobody around?" I said, "Nobody around." I said, "You sure there's nobody around?" "No, right." The next day, it actually happened. It's been verified. Verify that story. So listen, in the Florida game, if one of those guys starts running down the field, those Florida guys don't understand guns, so I'll just offer them money.
Is this the first time? Have we been here since you've been there? Is this your first time in this office?
I think it's first time in this office.
You, yeah, because last time, I think we were
downstairs.
Down there?
Yeah. Yeah, this is really nice. Yeah. This reminds me a little of the president's. United States office. You should get a seal on the rug. Yeah, show me. You ought to get a sneaker door in here. If you'll have the seal on the rug here, that would be perfect. Just a symbol on the rug. If you beat Florida, I'll come in here and weep it.
What's the commit down inside when they weigh in the block?
Yeah, but look at here, though. You still got this guy to take the quarterback, him to take the pitch.
This side.
I do it on this side. All right, then he got the quarterback. He gets the pitch.
You only need 1 yard, though. You got a guy that was the field.
Yeah,
you
come for 12 yards. If that guy comes up at all, you should have big yardage. Yeah. Wayne. So what you're saying? We should run to the pink side.
Huh?
We should run to the pink side. This is leverage side over here most of the time, isn't it? So we definitely should bring that thing right over here. Jarvis Williams. Look at him. See Williams committing here.
He can't help it.
He cannot help it. You got to get in there.
All right. 59 is going to end up being about the same.
Mm-hmm.
You know it.
Mm-hmm.
You got it.
I like the gut. I just think the down block just
takes
him like sucks him like flies. Oh, half sprint series. You used to run at Penn State, huh?
No,
a little half roll
no,
you used to
they,
use.
No.
Hey, that's about the one when the fat man could roll
that's
out
right. Hey, they didn't. They still thought I was set up.
Oh,
I
boy.
They had to get me somewhere.
Boy, I like that bell. God dang. Yes, that's a nice one.
Tell you what, the other kid is good one.
He's going to be a good one, too, yeah. And what you,
yeah,
really.
Can't separate right
yeah.
now.
You can't register one of them later on, can you?
Well, I mean,
can you register this kid?
God, I don't have anyone coming behind
yeah,
him.
Yeah,
so
right, yeah.
Death.
Can you can't gamble?
In fact, the other one, 7, is probably right now the next
pick. Is that right? Lascano, now where is he from?
He is manager.
Is that right?
I'm putting
kidding.
Yeah, I'm manager last.
Did he just walk off?
He's a manager here.
As long as that 12, as long as that 12 stays healthy, don't worry about a thing.
Yeah.
Okay, head to knee, ready? Put out! Hey! 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 All right, up, baby, okay. Let's get tailgunner real good, real good. Ready? Put out! Okay! 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 Okay, good job, good job. Now, men, there's only one. Look, you've already done the hard part. This is the fun part coming up. You've already worked your tail off. You've worked 10 ball games. You've had a good weeks of practice. This should be the fun part. Now, the one thing I don't want you to do is be tight. I want you to do two things for me. I want you to go out there and play and hit the field. Confident that we are the best football team in America. Now, who said we're not? Who can prove we're not? Nobody. So you hit that field with great confidence today. You see, all those fans up there, they came to see Florida State. They want to see what this Florida State team looks like. And then the second thing I want to ask you is do the best you can. Do the best you can. Do not worry about who is going to win the game. okay? You just play the best you can. Now, men, the last time we were down here, we took a bath, didn't we? How many of you guys were with us that day? Who all was down here that last time we played down here? Okay, me and you took a bath. Me and you took a bath. We were just, they intimidated us, didn't they? They cold flat intimidated us. And you guys were youngsters. You guys were youngsters. You were sophomores or maybe freshmen at that time. So let's go out there today and let us be the intimidators. Why not? Why not? Don't get any foolish penalties, but boy, let's show them who's boss. Establish the boss on the first play. Okay, let's have a word of prayer. Then our captain, when I get through, our captains will go on up towards the front and be ready to lead us out. Then we'll walk out together. And men, when we hit the field down there, let's try to all these up there together and hit it with a lot of confidence and a lot of pride and a lot of poise and a lot of enthusiasm, okay? All right. Dear God, thank you for this beautiful day. And thank you for our help. We pray that nobody will get hurt today. Protect us from injury. And we pray that you'll help our players to do the best they can. That's all we can. Just help them to do their best. Give our coaches wisdom in decision making. And our players. And we just hope we can win a great victory for you. And us. And our families. And our school. And our mama. And our daddies. Thy name we pray. Amen.
Toss sweep from the 7-yard line to Neil Anderson. Anderson finding a blocker, gets it to the one. He scores the touchdown. Neil Anderson with a last second lunge. Florida leading Florida State. Bell will drop back. He's got plenty of time to throw. Fakes short, now goes long, and downfield is the Teal. He's got it to the 20. Well, he wants to go upstairs again. He gets the pass away, and the end zone, the Teal, touchdown.
University of Florida is kicking the hell out of you. They're kicking your butt. Offense has not scored a touchdown. Offense has not even threatened. Captain's going out. Are you scared? Don't say that. Don't answer. Don't answer. Are you scared? You scared of them yellow shirts? Them orange shirts out there scare you a little bit? Intimidate you? Are you going to let them kick your butt like that? If they can score 28 points and a half, can we? Is it possible? Oh, yeah, Miami did it last. No, Maryland did it against Miami last year. They were down 31 and a half and came back and won it. We could do it. But we can't do it unless every man in here will just fight his guts out 30 more minutes.
If you run it out of all tight, it's there, folks.
Huh? What's that?
If you run it out of all tight, 46, Z takeoff.
Boyd on the carry.
Okay. How much we need?
By Williams.
Need 8. Okay, this will be all tight over, pass 46, Z takeoff. Give tailback, Billy. All tight over, pass 46, Z takeoff.
Come on back, Hassan.
Well, what happened then, Coach? This might be a touchdown here. Just watch this. This might be a touchdown. How much time do you need?
What'd you call?
Good job. Hey, let him go.
goes. Tim called, Brett.
I called.
Well, that's all right. That's good.
Yeah, I couldn't
did
get
they bite it? They must have bit it real
yeah,
good.
Yeah, they bit it.
Great. Hey, we're back in the game. Hey, we're back in the game. Hey, Isaac, we're back in the game. We're back in the game. Come on, Al. Let's go. We're back in the game. Come on, baby. We're back in the game. Hey, don't let anything deep now here. Well, I have a bomb. They can't score except that way. Hey, Chip, great job, son. Great job, baby. We're back in the game. Good job. Hey, Hassan, we're back in the game, baby. Back in the game. Come on, kid. Let's go. Back in the game now. Wrap that ball up and run here.
18, Kerwin Bell, play fakes and wants to throw. He's under pressure, throws it long downfield. It's caught by Beal. He's got it. High step into the 25. High step into the 10. Sanders cannot stop him. Touchdown.
Hey, you sure you don't want to transfer the club
today?
Great job.
Don't
great job, boy. Hey, man. Good to see you, babe. Great, yeah, son, you had a great job. Thank you. Same to you, buddy, Phil. Hey,
good,
y'all too good.
Y'all
too good. I'm sorry, your season's over.
Okay.
You might have the best team in the country.
Yeah, when we get ready to play.
Good to see you, buddy. I'll see you later. Okay. Hey, big man. Good to see you, my man.
Oh,
yes, y'all did a great job.
Thank you, Cole.
Y'all got a great ball club.
Yes,
proud
sir.
Of you.
Good luck.
Thank you. You okay, son?
Yeah, I'm all right.
Hey, I'm
just glad I had a... Well, the thing that excites me about Florida State University is that it is a relatively new school in the field of intercollegiate football and basketball. There's no doubt about it. When I was a kid, there wasn't a Florida State University football team, you know? There wasn't a Florida State basketball team. And yet, as I was growing up in college, I was able to compete against Florida State and saw that new young school down there growing. I was up in Alabama, but Florida State was in Tallahassee, and I was watching them grow. And I felt like you could see big time written on Florida State. And so being part of a university that, again, all of us that didn't have tradition yet, but I think right now we're in the middle of it. Again, I think the fact that some people are complaining about an 8-3 season tells you something about some tradition that's being built. And knowing also that 30 or 40 years from now, I will have been on the ground floor of Florida State building some great tradition. That's exciting to me. That's very exciting to me. And I hope I'm 56 years of age, and I'm getting up to the age where you start, you know, people start saying, how many interviews can you think I've had lately where they said, how much longer can you go? You know, well, boy, I hope I can go longer where I can contribute to Florida State. And yet I realize if we start going backwards with me, then we'll have to get somebody else younger to take it over. But it's exciting to me trying to build a tradition here.
Where's Patton at? Where's Pete Patton? Where's Patton? Where's Patton? Where's Patton? Where's Patton at? I know he's hiding. Where's Patton? Don't you jump off sides for Pete? We can't overcome a 1st and 15. We're trying to win the ball game. Sit in there, Hoss. Dadgummit. Now stay close to that line of scrimmage. And hey, Chip. Stay low where they can't find you. Stay low where they can't find you. Chip, Chip, that's good. Because see, now look, you can just imagine that safety back down there. He can't see you. You know, if I just drop back and raise up, he sees the ball up. That's all right. You know where he is. You know where he is. just stay a little bit lower where they can. That what you did then was perfect. See?
Oh, I'm proud of you. You're the best fireman in the country, baby. You're the best fireman in the country. Pardon me.
funding for the production.
Turf 27-14. But the Canes have also defeated Florida State, Maryland, and Notre Dame in putting together a 10-game winning streak.
But we can say that we have beaten the Big 8 champion, we have beaten the Atlantic Coast Conference champion, we've beaten some top independents, and we'd like to be able to say that we've beaten the Southeastern Conference champion. And so it's an important ball game for us to really call this year a success.
The key to Miami's offense is quarterback Vinny Testaverde, who emerged from the shadow of Bernie Kosar to become the leading Heisman Trophy candidate for next season.
Miami has a complete football team, a well-rounded, balanced football team. Their offense is very explosive and very potent. Good blocking, excellent receiving, good running, and a superb quarterback in Vinny Testaverde. It will challenge our defense the most it's been challenged all season, and they'll have to reach up and get something special, which I hope they can do. Testaverde is as good as there is in the country, and we will have to put it all together, so to speak, in this ballgame.
The game is a battle between two close friends. Majors was an assistant
Colorado coach, making its first bowl appearance since 1977. While in the Gator, Florida State with an explosive offense will test Oklahoma State with a repressive defense.
Washington was favored to win is an intriguing contrast, with Florida State bringing in one of the most exciting offenses in the country. The only problem for Bobby Bowden's Seminoles is that at times they give up points as quickly as they score them.
Our football team is a football team with some fine talent. I think we've probably got as much talent as we've had on any football teams at Florida State. But some of our talent is not quite ready yet.
Florida State will have the home crowd advantage, but this is not an altogether new proposition for Oklahoma State, which is in the Gator Bowl for the second year in a row.
We're the defending champions in the Gator Bowl. We take that very, very seriously. So there's a lot of reasons and a lot of pluses that I think will lead to us playing well.
The key for Oklahoma State is defense. Leslie O'Neal can destroy a team's entire offensive game plan if he is not contained at the line of scrimmage.
There are three more games on New Year's Eve. Air Force.
The Bull Rush has given us enduring classics and some. If the Rose Bowl is the granddaddy of them all, then let me introduce you to a distant nephew. Monday night's Freedom Bowl from Anaheim. The University of Washington, a four-point favorite over the University of Colorado. Two teams in turn engagement in the Gator Bowl. Many thought this would be the breakthrough year for the Cowboys to finally conquer the behemoths of the Big Eight. But Oklahoma State fell to both Nebraska and Oklahoma in Stillwater. The key for the Cowboys is again Thurman Thomas, who triggers a run-happy attack. This will be Thomas's showcase game as a first step towards next year's Heisman chase. But the object Monday night is to win the Gator Bowl, and the Cowboys are decided 7-point underdogs to Florida State. The Seminoles, though, have problems, specifically number one quarterback Danny McManus, who won't play because of an injury. Freshman Chip Ferguson steps in. He'll find Victor Floyd as a receiver and to run the ball, along with the other key to the attack, running back Tony Smith.